So today let's explore those internals of a power drill I accidentally came across. It has this holder for a drill bit or screwdriver bit, this torque setting, probably a gearbox here, a motor here, and some switch, which probably also contains some regulation for the motor, and a connector to the battery, and also some transistor on heat sink, which is the part of this regulation circuitry. Unfortunately, I don't have the battery pack for it, but anyway, it still looks like an interesting thing to explore. So let's take it completely apart and see how does it work. But before this, can I actually test it? Can I power it without the battery? I probably can connect it to my power supply, and what's the voltage? The switch says the maker, some part number probably, and DC 7.2 to 15 volts, 12 amps. And the connector to the battery doesn't say anything. Here's a transistor, and the motor says 12 volts. So let's try to connect it to a 12 volt power supply. So here is 12 volts from my power supply, and the current limit of the power supply is set to about 40 amps. This should be enough. So let's try to connect it to the power supply instead of a battery, and what happens? No explosion, it's connected, and let's give it some beans. And nothing. It's dead. But there seems to also be something that selects the polarity to choose the direction of the motor. What if I move it and try it once more? Well, it runs now. It even regulates. And does it go the other direction? Yes, it does. It works. And it draws about 2 amps when it's not loaded. So it seems it works, but there is a switch for the direction, and if you leave it in the middle, it doesn't work. But anyway, let's try to further open it. There seems to be something clicked onto it, and it opens. This polarity switch, probably is a separate unit, changes the polarity of the motor to reverse it. And the regulator is here. Can I open it somehow? Let's try to pry it. And from the other side as well. Can I pry it open? Yes. And it opens. And this is the button with the spring, nothing else in this one. Just a slider, some plastic cover, and the rest of it is here. And there is probably some sliding potentiometer. It seems to be a sliding potentiometer with 2 contacts. One is probably sliding on just some metal, and the other one on some resistive track, with some connections going to them probably, and it further opens and it falls apart. Here's the potentiometer with the contacts and a chip, a resistor, another resistor, a capacitor SMD1. This is an 8-pin chip probably, and that's it. There is really not much of it in it. And this is a metal oxide varistor, it looks like. And the slider seems to have a double function. It was sliding this big contact, a power contact, on those contacts here, and to basically connect it to power when you press it, and also it was sliding this small contact on this potentiometer to regulate the speed of the motor. And it's also like a terminal block with some connections, and the transistor was connected here, and it has a marking on it. Source, drain, and gate. So it has a connection for an external power transistor, which is this one. It's on a small heat sink and the marking of it is... No, it's better visible. And here are the contacts from the terminal block and the other markings are probably battery negative, battery positive and motor 1, motor 2. And this one, which looks like a metal oxide varistor, is probably to limit the inductive spikes. It probably clamps the inductive spikes from the motor to protect the transistor and this chip. And here's the marking of the chip, quite short, just the DK1. And of course here's the schematic of it, and it contains a chip, probably for pulse width modulation of the motor. It pulse width modulates this switching transistor, the pulse width modulation signal goes into its gate and it regulates the duty cycle for this motor. And the motor is connected via a polarity switch, this rotary polarity selector. And there is this metal oxide varistor in parallel to the motor to clamp its inductive voltage overshoots or spikes, especially when you turn the motor off, when the transistor turns off. And also inductive spikes from the brushes of the motor because it's a brushed motor. And when you press the switch, it basically moves two things. This potentiometer, but also this sliding contact. When the switch is not pressed, the negative of the battery is basically disconnected, and as you press it, the contact gets to this part and connects the source of the transistor and the negative of the chip probably, and it starts pulse width modulating. The pulse width modulation goes into the gate of the transistor, it's switching and regulating the motor. And as you press it more, it increases the duty cycle and the transistor also switches at a higher duty cycle and the motor runs faster. And the chip basically has some capacitor in some oscillator probably and this circuitry regulates the duty cycle going into the gate. The more you move the potentiometer down, the higher the duty cycle. And when you press the switch all the way down, this contact gets here on this connection and basically bypasses the transistor and connects the motor directly to the battery. So when the switch is pressed all the way, the motor is connected directly with no regulation, straight to the battery. And here's the battery, which may contain some protections in it, especially a protection against a deep discharge, in case it's a lithium-ion battery. But I don't have the battery, so I don't know. Maybe it's about 3 lithium-ion cells in a series with some protection, or in the older ones it could be 10 nickel-cadmium cells in a series and they don't need any protection. So that's basically it. A polarity selector, a pulse width modulation with a chip and transistor and a bypass for the maximum power. And the bypass helps to reduce the losses in the transistor. And the switch is basically this contact, sliding on those contacts, like this. As you press it, it initially connects the regulation and when you press it all the way, it bypasses the transistor. And it also moves this slider on this resistive track, which basically creates a potentiometer. And it goes into the chip and it changes the duty cycle of the pulse width modulation. And that's it. It's quite simple. And of course now it's back together. And does it work? It does. And of course now the pulse width modulation of the motor on my oscilloscope. A very low duty cycle. And it goes up. And maximum. It's a pulseless modulation, but the signal is quite rough because it's a brushed motor. It generates a lot of interference. And what if I try to measure the gate of the MOSFET instead of the motor? The transistor keeps switching even if it's bypassed, but it probably doesn't matter. And the pulseless modulation frequency is about 10 kHz. And the pulseless modulation does work, but kind of roughly. Maybe it's because there is no capacitor in parallel to the power of the chip. Maybe it would be a better idea to have some capacitor in parallel to it like this, and maybe even some resistor capacitor filter, something like a resistor and going into the positive of it and filtering the noise from the switching and from the brushed motor. Basically, let's disconnect it here and maybe this would work better. And of course, there are also some transistors with much lower on-state resistance, so with those it wouldn't even be necessary to have a heat sink on the transistor, and then the transistor could have been built into this module instead of having it dangling on the wires like this. And of course, using a transistor with a very low on-state resistance would allow to completely delete this switch, because this mechanical sliding contraption that switches high currents will eventually wear out. So it would be probably possible to switch the motor using just the transistor and get rid of this one, and the on-state resistance of some transistors is just like 1 or 2 milliohms, so the switch wouldn't be necessary. The transistor could pass the full current, so this bypass wouldn't be necessary, and even this, because some chips have such a low standby current that they can be connected to the battery all the time. So it could be controlled by just this potentiometer. Of course, this crazy regulation is a bit non-linear because it runs up to like a bit over 50% and then it jumps to full power suddenly. So I believe this could have been designed much better. And should I take a peek inside of the gearbox? Isn't it going to fly apart? Let's see. And, well, it's kind of falling apart, but not too much. And it seems to be two sets of planetary gears in a row. Those ones and another ones here. Now it seems that the center of this one is connected to the output shaft. And this small gear, the sun gear, probably is going to those three planetary gears in the other section, and the motor basically drives the sun gear in this set. It's a double reduction. The motor basically drives the sun gear in the first set of planetary gears, and those planetary gears are then driving the sun gear in the other set, and the planets are basically driving the output shaft. And it seems that some of the gears are metal, some of them are plastic. This looks metal, but those three small ones in the first section are plastic. Can I further take it apart? And this is basically the outer section with the teeth from the inside, and this one is probably not moving, or it's actually moving only if it's slipping, because there is a mechanism pressing those balls into it and they go into those, and you basically set a certain torque on this dial and this regulates how much force actually press those balls into this. And when you exceed a certain torque, this one starts slipping and it basically limits the tightening torque. As you turn this dial, it kind of presses those balls tighter into it using some spring. And that's it. And now let's try to put it back together. There is some grease in it and those gears. I hope both sides of them are the same. Let's put them back onto those shafts. Let's reinsert this part, like this, if I can maybe, well I can't, there is the edge, so I have to figure out how to put it back together now. it's not so easy to put back together because you have to put those planets into this one first before putting it in. It's quite tricky. So now it's back together and the other part of it is probably easier. Just put this one in. Then put the plastic planets on it. 1, 2, 3. And there is also some metal disc on the motor and then the motor goes back in. And that's it. And now it fits together. And I could reuse this to make some winding machine for windings or Tesla coil secondaries. It's quite nice. So this is Dying Wild and see you in my next videos and thanks to all of my patrons on Patreon. I really appreciate your support. And of course you can also become my patron to support my channel and to get early videos. And this big power supply is coming in the next video. It's the 12 volt 600 watt one. Quite an interesting one.